Hello everyone, so today I am here to discuss a new topic of interpretation of clinical laboratory tests. So we'll discuss what are the basic tests which is being used to test or to identify to diagnose of any of the diseases for the treatment of diseases. So let's start. First, we'll do what is laboratory data, how it is helping. So laboratory data provides understanding of patient's health. It will tell about what is the patient's health and physiological function. Yes, if we are giving any drug to the patient, how much drug is present, how it is giving therapeutic efficacy, any side effects. So we'll monitor it by laboratory test. Let's see what are the applications of laboratory data, why it is important. So it is important for reviewing patient current therapy. If we are giving any of the drug to the patient, we can see how it is, how the patient is responding with it. So for reviewing the patient condition, then there is drug is appropriate or not. So we can monitor by it. If it is not appropriate, there are some other modifications we can do. Another is, this is also the part of the modification because we are doing the dose adjustment here on the basis of how much the drug actually reaches to the body, means the bioavailability. There are many reasons by which the bioavailability alters. So if we can modify the dose, it can be done by the laboratory data also. Another is the adequacy of a dose response. So it is also monitored by the laboratory data. Another is the efficacy of treatment, how the drug is effective. So for the monitoring, for the follow-up, there is also one of the concepts. How we are modifying the drug, we are checking the drug present in the body, which is called as a therapeutic drug monitoring. In this, laboratory data is required. Another point is, if any serious drug toxicity occur in the patients, to try to find whatever the drug is present, how much drug is present. So for that also laboratory data is required. Now we'll do first blood chemistry test. So in the blood chemistry test, what are the basic tests? We'll do first, electrolytes are there. In this, we'll check sodium levels, potassium levels, yes, phosphate levels, calcium levels, like this. Another is, there are some tests for the kidney assessment, how the kidney is working. Another is some tests for the liver and pancreas. Then for blood sugar, another could be the protein assessment in the body, it is also affecting the body. Another is the fat. So these all tests will cover in the blood chemistry testing. First come with the electrolytes level, sodium, potassium, calcium, chloride and phosphate. So these all five ions will cover in the electrolyte testing. The sodium, the reference value is this. If the reference value, as it is mentioned, 135 to 145 millimole per liter. So if it is decreased with this reference value, we call it as a hyponatremia. Yes, this condition is called hyponatremia. So we are using natremia word here. For the higher, if the value is higher than this reference value, we call it the hypernatremia. What are the conditions associated with hyponatremia and hyponatremia? See, we have just taken some of the examples here. If the sodium levels in the blood, yes, it is low or less than this reference value, we call it the hyponatremia, and the situation occurs in the diarrhea or fluid loss, vomiting, excessive sweating. These all are the condition of fluid loss. Use of diuretics, the patient is using any of diuretic. If the patient is suffering from kidney disease, in this what happens? The sodium losses, sodium will excrete out. Much of sodium will excrete out, of course, in the body, in the blood. Sodium will present in less amount. Or sometimes what happens with the cortisol, aldosterol or sex hormones. With this, with all these conditions, the situation occurs hyponatremia. Other, we can see for the hypernatremia. In this condition, if there is a severe dehydration, there is a very high fluid loss. In that condition, what happens? If there is a fluid loss, the concentration of sodium increases in the body. Yes. So severe vomiting, if the patient is taking very high sodium diet, in that time the situation occurs as the increase of sodium level in the blood, which is called hypernatremia. Another condition is potassium, and with the potassium we call it as a hypokalemia. If the value is higher than this reference value, we call it as hyperkalemia. What is the condition associated with it? We'll see. If patient is taking low potassium diet, so potassium will present low in the body. Of course, then there is a gastrointestinal disorders. Potassium is not absorbed properly. If it is excreted in very high quantity, when it happens? Of course, when there is a kidney disorders. So if the patient is suffering from diarrhea condition, vomiting condition, patient is taking lot of diuretic drugs, so at the time what happens? Potassium will be lower in the body, in the blood. In second scenario, if the potassium increases in the blood, in this we can see patient is taking high potassium intake. The diet is with high potassium. There are some of the medications also like NSAIDs, non-steroidal anti-inflammatory drugs, some painkillers, beta blockers are there. For angiotensin converting enzyme inhibitors, ARBs and diuretics. Some patients are suffering from the kidney failure also. At that time, the kidney is not able to excrete out the potassium. At that time, the potassium levels will increase in the blood. So this happens. Another is the scenario with the calcium. We can see with the calcium, the low levels, we call it the hypocalcemia. Whereas in the high, we call it the hypercalcemia. So in hypocalcemia, what happens means the calcium level present in the blood is low, and there are reason called as a hypoparathyroidism. So parathyroid hormone is basically responsible for the regulation of calcium. When there is a low parathyroid hormone, what happens? The calcium level will be low. Another is the kidney failure. At the time of kidney failure, kidney is not able to absorb the calcium. So calcium will be low in the blood. There is another condition called as pancreatitis. Pancreas is also responsible because some of the calcium is also present in the pancreas, pancreatic juices. So at the inflammation, calcium will decrease. Problems when there is absorption, when there is a problem associated with the absorption of calcium, there's some of the medication also responsible for the lowering the calcium level, such as corticosteroids, anticonvulsants, rifampicin, these all drugs. Whereas the opposite can be seen in this side for the hypercalcemia. What happens if parathyroid hormone, hyperparathyroidism situation occurs? If there is a kidney or adrenal gland failure, in this situation what happens? The kidney is not able to excrete out the calcium. Yes? So the condition occurs, the calcium will be higher in the blood. There are some drugs called lithium, thiazide diuretics, if we are taking any calcium supplement, any vitamin D supplementation, so they will increase the calcium levels. Another is the chloride. What happens with the chloride? We'll see. This is the reference value and the conditions we call for the hypochloremia and hyperchloremia. So heart failure is there. If patient is suffering from heart failure, patient is suffering from lung disease, or patient is suffering from any disease such as Addison's disease, so in this condition what happens? The chloride level will be lower in the body. Yes. Another scenario we can see, dehydration and kidney disease. If a patient is suffering from these of the two conditions, of course it could be associated with higher chloride levels in the blood. Another is phosphate. With the phosphate we can see hypophosphatemia and hyperphosphatemia. Yes, lowering and higher. Now the situation called as a hyperparathyroidism. So parathyroid hormone is working here, and it is working as for the regulation of calcium as well as for the phosphate. So if there is a high parathyroid hormone, so what happens? The phosphate levels will be low. there is a malnutrition, patient is not taking phosphate in the diet. Then the patient is suffering from alcohol, patient is taking lot of alcohol, which is called as a alcoholism. Acetamalacia is there, bones are weakened, bones weaken, at the time phosphate will be lower. Yes, or both of the both conditions are associated. Vitamin D, patient is suffering from vitamin D deficiency, bone are weakened here, rickets is also one of the conditions. So these are conditions associated with low of potassium, whereas the higher side, for the higher levels we can see, if a patient is suffering from kidney disease, yes, means the kidney is not properly excreting the potassium. Hyperparathyroidism we have discussed. Similarly, we can see if the situation is opposite, hypoparathyroidism, of course the phosphate level will be high. Yes, this is called the feedback mechanism, how the parathormone is working. So if the patient is taking lot of vitamin D supplements, patient is taking excess of phosphate, patient is suffering from diabetic ketoacidosis. So these are the condition which is associated with the values of phosphate. Now we'll cover the kidney test, kidney assessment. So for the kidney assessment, what are the tests? Test is, first is creatinine and another is the blood urea nitrogen. Creatinine is very specific test for kidney assessment. This is, the values are, we can see 0.8 to 1.2 mg per deciliter, whereas the for females it is 0.06 to 0.6 to 0.9 mg per deciliter. Now this test provides a sensitive measure of the renal damage. As I told you, this is very specific test for kidney, and because renal impairment is virtually the only cause of creatinine elevation. When there is an elevation in the creatinine level, there is a chances of kidney damage. There is a chances where the kidney is not working properly. And also, as the creatinine is the metabolic product of the protein, so in the patients who are suffering from gigantism and acromegaly, yes, this happens as if there is an overgrowth in children. Yes, whereas acromegaly is the overgrowth in adult. So in both of the condition the creatinine level can be high. Yes, another is the blood urea nitrogen. This is also test for the kidney assessment. Blood urea nitrogen is the measure of waste. This is also one of the product which is formed from the waste in the blood. The normal BUN levels is 7 to 20 mg per deciliter. So these two tests are basically performed for the assessment of kidney. And after this, there is a test for the liver assessment. So these are some of the tests. One is the AST, ALT, prothrombin test, albumin and bilirubin. The other test also, but we have taken just some of them. So AST is one of the enzyme, yes, aspartate transferase, another is the alanine transferase, prothrombin time, as some of the clotting factors are also formed in the liver. So if there is a problem with the prothrombin time, it is correlated with the liver. There is the albumin and bilirubin, this is also formed in the liver. So what happens if there is a damage in the liver? The levels will be disturbed. As AST, we can see 5 to 40 units per liter, the level reference values is this. ALT, the reference values are 7 to 56 unit per liter. These two type of test, the values are increased at the time of liver injury. If there is inflammation, if the patient is suffering from hepatitis, yes, if there is any blockage, yes, the patient is suffering from cancer of liver or liver cancer, we call it liver cancer, yes, and if the patient is also suffering from any heart disorder or heart disease, because these enzymes are also present in the heart. So at the time of any of these situation, their levels will be rising. Another is prothrombin time. Some of the clotting factors are are being formulated, we can say prepared in the formed in the liver. So prothrombin time will be disturbed here. Of course, this is also used to check the if patient is suffering from any of the bleeding disorder. Yes. Another is the albumin and bilirubin. So albumin is also formed in the liver, and if it is disturbed, if the liver is damaged, if the liver is injured, or any of the conditions such as I have mentioned, then their levels will be either increased or decreased. Another is test for the pancreas. So for the assessment of pancreas, we can see few tests. One is amylase, another is lipase. So amylase and lipase test are performed for the assessment of pancreas. What is the function of amylase and lipase? So we'll cover. See, for the amylase, it is used for the breakdown of carbohydrate. Yes. Lipase is used for the breakdown of lipids, as the name mentioned here. So the normal values we can see for the amylase, it's 23 to 85 units per liter, whereas for the lipase level, it is 0 to 160 unit per liter. If there is increased in it, as the condition mentioned, pancreatitis suspected, the patient is suffering from the inflammation of pancreas. Here the values rise in more than 200 units per liter. Similarly, for the lipase, we can see it is also more than 200 per liter. So if the levels increase, pancreatitis could be suspected in the patient. Another is the blood sugar parameters. It is also taken care at the time of diabetes. The patient is suspected with a diabetes, then there are 2-3 tests are being performed on the patient. One is at the time of fasting. If the patient had not taken any of the diet, which is called as a fasting condition, the at this time blood sample is taken, blood sample is taken and evaluated for the glucose level. So the levels are 72 to 99 mg per deciliter in normal patients at the time of fasting. If it is between 280 to 130 mg per deciliter, it means the patient is suspected with a diabetes. Yes. Another condition is called as a postprandial situation. In this condition, what happens, we are giving the diet to the patient, we are giving a glucose meal to the patient, and then we'll take the sample, blood sample. If it is less than 140 mg per deciliter, then it is normal. Otherwise, if it is more than 180 mg per liter, we call it as a patient with a suspected diabetes. Another test is called as a A1C results. These tests is performed in a patient to test if either the patient is diabetic or not, and these tests are giving results called as 3-month result. Yes, these tests are basically performed at the interval of 3 months, and in this test we are trying to find out the glycated RBCs. Yes, as the age of RBC is for 3 months, 120 days, so these tests are giving the results which we calling as a 3-month results. So in this test, we are trying to find out how many RBCs which are glycated, which are with the glucose, which are conjugated with glucose. So the levels are here for the normal patients, the levels are 5.7%. For diabetic patient, it is less than 7%. So if the values are more than 5.7 to 7%, of course, the patient is suffering from diabetes. Now, another test is being performed on the proteins. So, there are some of the proteins which is being evaluated is albumin and globulin. Now, albumin is being tested, and from the values of the albumin, we can find the liver and kidney conditions. How the kidneys are working, how the livers are working. So, find out if diet contains enough protein. Sometimes what happens, the patient is not taking enough protein, so levels will be lower, or if the patient is taking heavy protein diet, levels can be high. Help determine the cause of swelling of the ankles. What happens if there is a lowering level of albumin. So the water or the fluid present in the blood cells, it starts to move to the tissues, and there is a condition called as edema. There is a swelling just by the fluids, ascites, because there is a swelling in the abdomen, fluid accumulation in the abdomen area. And situation occur called as, if there is accumulation of fluid in the lungs, it will cause the shortness of breath. Another is globulin. This is also one of the protein, and this is formed in the liver. This protein is usually showing the significance at the time of infection. Yes. So determine the chances of developing an infection, and if the patient is suffering from any of the blood disease, any cancer, microglobulinemia situation. So in this all condition, what happens if the patient is suffering from any of the infection, globulin level will be disturbed. There are some of the reference values I have mentioned. For the albumin, the two alpha albumins, and for the globulins, the other two types here, alpha 1 and alpha 2. Similarly, there is also beta globulin. So values are mentioned here. If the values got changed, of course, the patient is suffering from any of the conditions I have mentioned in the previous slide. Now there is a test called as, here we'll evaluate the fats. The fats could be total cholesterol, LDL cholesterol, HDL cholesterol, and triglycerides. So these levels should be identified. And as the elevated, I'm taking an example here, elevated triglycerides place an individual at a risk of atherosclerosis. So what happens here is the accumulation of fats in the arteries. So triglyceride level should be less than 150 mg per deciliter. If it is higher, of course, there is a chances of accumulation of fat in the arteries, and it will cause the heart attack, of course. Yes. Another, triglycerides and cholesterol levels are measured in the blood as they are causing the risk to the patients. Yes. So total cholesterol level should be less than 200 mg per deciliter. Another, in the cholesterol, we are categorizing the cholesterol in the two parts. One is HDL, another LDL, another is HDL. LDL means low density lipoprotein, whereas HDL is high density lipoprotein. Low density lipoprotein means the lipids with a low density, means these lipids are able to move from one place to another place. So for this reason, they are called as bad fat. Yes. Whereas high density lipoprotein, because of the weight we are talking of, the density is high, they cannot move from one place to another place. They are accumulated at one place only. So they are called as a good fat. Yes. For the HDL cholesterol, we can see the levels are less than 100 mg per deciliter. Yes. For the HDL, high density lipoproteins, the levels are more than 60 mg per deciliter. So we'll talk of all these tests while performing the blood chemistry test. I hope you all got about these blood chemistry tests. So thank you so much, everyone. We'll meet in the next session.